Most of the things that are happening in society, most of the things that are happening in our communities, we are not partakers in what is happening.
Amen.
Simply because some of us, our voice is the least to be heard.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Most of the decisions that are happening, we are just victims of decisions of voices and thoughts that are heard. Some of us, we are at schools. We really cannot decide otherwise because we are even struggling with the little thing that we are sent there for.
Yeah.
Some of us, we are in church, even speaking out, praying out is a struggle.
Amen.
Now, this for many has caused people to desert God, to hate God, to turn away from God, to not trust God.
Yes,
I honor somebody that goes to a herbalist. I honor somebody that goes to a nyanga, to a witch doctor. I honor those people because they are trying to say that they've tried to work on God for such a long time and it's not good for them.
Sure.
So the church has become like blood stuck in a small vein. The church is dying.
Sure.
When I say church, I don't mean necessarily this one. I mean the whole body of Christ. We are beginning to lose the tangible nature of God. Our only advantage, when God is moved from spirituality to religiosity, we are losing advantage, but we are carrying the truth. We'll be saying, by the blood of Jesus I'm healed, but there's no healing. We'll be saying, yokes of poverty must break, but they will not break. So we are carrying a revelation that can never find demonstration, that can never find manifestation or materialization in our own everyday life. I've come to a place of moving from doctrine to doctrine, moving from scripture to scripture. And then after, you know, when you've read the Bible for too long, there are only two things among many things that will happen to you. Number one is, when you begin to experience it, you hold on firmly to it. Number two is, when you do not experience it, you begin to look for a different solution. So I honor people that are backsliding in the season. It's a sign that people are not experiencing the demonstrative and transformative power of God. Some of us, we have seen that here today. You know, it's even this one, we deserve an award for it. You've prayed and you didn't receive any answer. You've trusted God and nothing has happened, but you're still holding on. You deserve an award for that one.
Amen. Amen.
The world thinks of us to be foolish, to trust in a God that is not working for us. But here is the greatest problem. I figured out that we are not understanding the Bible correctly. And I'm not saying we are doctrinally in error. We are doctrinally aligned to what God wants to reveal, but we are not understanding the Bible correctly.
Sure.
The Bible should not be a religious book. It should not be a devotionary book. That's why the Bible calls it the law of God. It does not say the devotion of God. We don't read it to worship. We read it for it to work, not worship. There is work that must be done by every scripture. Every scripture is a key. It's a door opener. Every scripture. When I say door, I don't mean prosperity, please. Every scripture is a door opener. There is a specific door that must be opened by every scripture. A door to peace must be opened by scripture. There is something that the scripture must unlock as we are tripartites in every dimension of our tripartital being. There is a door that every scripture must open. If it's not working in our spirit, it must work in our soul. If it's not working in our soul, it must work in our body. If not in our body, it must work in all three spheres at the same time. Now, this reality that I'm preaching to you, that's why I said you must pray for intimacy, to pray for a sensitive hearing, so that what is being spoken must become another catalyst to the investment that has been done on your life. Let me already tell you this: God is not going to give you grace. He has already given you grace. God is not going to bless you. He has already blessed you. God is not going to prosper you. He's already prospered you. What we are struggling with now is realizing what God has done.
Amen.
When you go to heaven, you will weep if God told you that I wanted you to affect the world. There's a man by the name of Benson Idiosa. He traveled 256 countries 52 times.
Sure.
The whole world has 256 countries, planet Earth. He traveled each one 52 times and died. Some of us, we are minimizing grace. We are so small-minded, we are saying that grace is about traveling. No, it's not about traveling. Grace is about doing what is historically, in terms of your own life, impossible. It comes from an area in Nigeria called Benin, one of the poorest areas that was bound by witchcraft.
Yes, sir.
You know there is something working on your life. When you come from an area of the most disadvantaged people, yeah, and when you go to an area of the most advantaged people, that you are more advantaged than them.
Yeah. Yes, Prophet.
You know that there is something working on your life.
Yes, sir.
Naturally, people who are advantaged, when they meet somebody who comes from a disadvantaged world, they must still be better than that person.
Yeah.
But because of a speedling, because of a apostolic grace that is working upon somebody disadvantaged, they become more advantaged than the disadvantaged. They also become more advantaged than the advantage. It's not comparison, it's understanding the power of grace. So today I just want to give you one of the elements that are going to be at work in your life. You must understand this thing with all of your heart. You must invest your spirit, your mind, your body, your whole being. You must invest it in this for you to be advantaged. My desire is you hear God spiritually.
Amen.
All right. Let me start with a bit of impression. Let me impress you too quickly and move away from that. All right. The grandson of Abraham, Jacob, later named Israel, the one that wrestled with God, the befriended of God. He had 12 children. Right, he had 12 sons. Now, when he had 12 sons, one of his sons was by the name of Issachar. My personal conviction is each son was different giftedly. Was gifted differently. Or differently gifted. Each son was gifted in a different way. That is just symbolic or allegoric or figurative, that all of us sitting here today, we are gifted differently.
Amen.
But out of your gift, there are laws that are operating out of your gift that are regulating, catalyzing, and minimizing the potential of causing your gift to cause you to become everything that God has anticipated and expected you to become before the creation of the world.
Amen.
All right. There are laws, both divine, natural, and subnatural laws that are at work that you can't control. What is a law? It's something that you can't alter. It's something you can't change. You can't wish it otherwise. You can't pray for it to move. One of those laws, I'm going to discuss it today. Because we can't hijack them otherwise, we must find a way of maneuvering, of manipulating, altering this law without breaking it, so that we can penetrate it and have an advantage.
Sure.
I want to discuss this one. Time. It's a law of time.
Yes, sir.
Whether you like it or not, you have to go through the gate of yesterday to get to today, and today you have to go through the gate of today to get to tomorrow. You like it or not, you're prayerful or not, you can never escape time.
Amen. Amen.
You are a subject, a creature to time.
Amen.
The most deepest element of God that has become a monument in this natural universe as we know it is time. If you don't understand time, and I don't want you to go study chronology to understand time, that is useless. Whether you study chronology or classical chronology, it is still useless. You'll go graduate and become a chronologist and still not understand time. Because my inspiration and aspiration of saying understand time, when I know that you understand it, is when you are able to use it and abuse it to get the greatest advantage.
Amen.
And let me already tell you this. Much time has been lost this one is the discovery of Ziggler Eisenkonga. Much time has been lost. 2020-2021, much time has been lost. Especially by people who were not having jobs. Especially by the people who are not doing anything with their lives. So because much time has been lost, your life equals to poverty when you cannot capitalize on the investment of time given to you. Poverty equals to life minus activity that brings productivity on time. That is poverty. And poverty is it is dimensional. You can have intellectual poverty. When I say intellectual poverty is my people perish because they lack knowledge. It means you are poor intellectually. You don't have knowledge. There is emotional poverty. When you don't have peace, you are frustrated. Frustration, depression, anxiety, question, grudges, unforgiveness, they are resentment, hate, anger. They are a sign of spiritual poverty. It means you are mining in the gold mine of the devil.
Amen.
What depression comes to do, it comes to steal away time from you. So that you don't invest time in what can properly cause you to have terrestrial, spiritual, and supernatural advantage.
Amen.
That's exactly what lack of information does. Some of us, we have financial poverty, economic poverty. We don't have money.
Amen.
Not having money is a curse. Not because having money is a blessing, but because not having money causes what God has wants to do in your life